have the privilege this morning of chairing a session with three very renowned presenters, and I think my job, therefore, will be a simple one. Our first presenter will be Mr. William Hines. William is the Senior Technical Officer of the Ministry of Finance, Investment, Telecommunications, and Energy. William has been involved in renewable energy for over 25 years, in spite of the fact that he does not look it, his most youthful appearance. And he's worked at several regional institutions as a consultant, as well as the project manager. And he's filled numerous other roles, including volunteer, driver of solar shuttle, etc. He's worked or collaborated or at least assessed almost every major renewable energy project in Barbados and indeed around the region. William is an innovator who leads Barbados in the development of solar electric vehicles, and he holds an MSc in alternative energy from Reading in the United Kingdom. Our second presenter is Mr. James Husbands. James is probably best known for his work locally, regionally, and internationally, really in being the architect and oftentimes telling the tale himself as to the success story of the commercialization of the solar hot water industry. He has received numerous awards for his work, including a Barbados National Honor, being the Gold Crown of Merit, the regional award, the Anthony N. Sabga Caribbean Award for Excellence in Science and Technology, and the International Pioneer Award from the World Renewable Energy Network. James has designed a solar hot water storage tank, which is widely used in the industry, and he's also designed aluminum extrusions, including collector storm extrusion, for high wind conditions, and certainly we would recognize that this is key in a region such as ours if we are to pursue such technologies in a major way. Mr. Husbands is the product of the Princess Margaret School in the Christchurch High School. His business partner and co-developer, Ivan Franklin, is also a product of the Princess Margaret School. And our third presenter is Dr. Roland Clark. Roland has been involved in energy engineering and economics of systems for some 27 years, working with experience specifically in renewable energy, energy efficiency, electric utility planning, and energy policy. His private practice is Clark Energy Associates, and he's an authorized reseller of solar photovoltaics and small wind energy systems for residential and commercial applications. Dr. Clark is a former project manager of the Caribbean Renewable Energy Development Program at the CARICOM Secretariat and the coordinator of the CARICOM Task Force on Regional Energy Policy. He's also worked for electric utilities in the United States of America, and he's conducted in-house seminars for the World Bank on several continents. Dr. Clark holds a PhD in energy management and policy from the University of Pennsylvania in the USA and an MSc in alternative energy from the University of Reading in the United Kingdom. He also holds his BSc in natural sciences from the University of the West Indies Cave Hill campus. And so, ladies and gentlemen, I think you would certainly recognize from the bios that these are gentlemen not just with considerable qualifications, but also considerable practical experience in this industry. And I think, ladies and gentlemen, they will assist us in setting the framework and giving us a bit of background information for those of you for whom this is a first-time experience with respect to renewable energies. And so without any further ado, ladies and gentlemen, I will invite the first presenter, Mr. William Hines, to the podium. William?
Simple steps to greater use of alternative energy. And before I begin, let me say it's really wonderful to see so many people here. This is reason to celebrate. Congratulations to all of you who have made that decision to come and attend and participate. I believe that we have a technology to achieve a revolution in the way we use energy in Barbados and the world. In fact, I believe that the third revolution that was spoken about by Jeremy Refkin at the Central Bank lecture a year ago of achieving 100% alternative energy is possible and can be achieved. I will present 20, some steps I consider simple, not so simple, that can be your toolbox for greater use of alternative energy. Step one, set targets. Minister Boyce, Honorable Boyce, indicates that Barbados can perhaps in 20 years reach 29% renewable energy. Over a decade ago, 20% in Europe was considered an ambitious target. And the United States, lagging behind, had a target of 10%. Today, the European Union is closing in on greater targets. Several countries have exceeded the 20%. In fact, a number of them have exceeded 50%. They have in May launched Renewable Energy Thinking 2050. Ideas to take Europe to 100% renewable energy by 2050. California had a target of 33%, increased from 20% in 2004. And of course, Hawaii, not to be outdone, now has a target of 70%. We set targets for retirement, targets to become rich, get educated, and today when you leave here, you can set a target for your company, your home, or even your country. Step two, the Minister Boyce indicated unlock viable investments. We should act on low-hanging fruit. The SEF report the minister spoke about indicated that wind both onshore and offshore are now among our low-hanging fruit, wind farms. Biomass is cost effective. The minister indicated that waste energy is also a viable investment, as well as PV thermals, and of course, the origin of our solar alternative energy industries is solar water heaters. So we need to look at low-hanging fruit and take action. Step three. Buy a solar water heater. Why do I say buy a solar water heater? Well, the simple answer is we have created the solar water heater industry in Barbados and the Caribbean. We dominate the Caribbean. We actually invented the word solar water heaters in the Caribbean. And we are the leaders not only among the Caribbean, but we are among the leaders in the world in terms of solar water heaters per population or per houses. We have to celebrate this achievement and we have to carry it further. 30% of our households, 40% is no longer enough. We need to aim for 100%. So if you don't have a solar water heater, you should buy one. And if you have a solar water heater, you should advise your neighbor to get one. We need to make it real. We need to take it over the top. Barbados, through the leadership of our solar water heater industries, pioneered 1974 by Solar Dynamics, can do this, and we will. Step four. The minister said wind is viable, large-scale wind. Small-scale wind may not be as viable because most times it's in areas where there's little wind. The wind blows the blades of these wind turbines, shaft rotates, and turn electric generator. The electrons race out of the turbine and into the grid, or your house or your farm. There are a number of wind sites in Barbados that are windy enough to produce electricity cheaper than can be produced using fossil fuels. Most of us in the renewable energy community know that. I've known it for a long time. It was viable back then when it was maybe $60 a barrel, and $70, $80 a barrel, it is even more viable. So this is a technological no-brainer. Find the good wind sites, use the good sites. And as you can see from the picture, some of the issues relating to whether or not wind sites are concerned, we have a message here from the farms. Animals that indicate that they are more afraid of the farmers than the wind turbines. So, next step. Install a solar electric system any size.
solar panels that look similar to the water heater panels are used to sustainably transfer the sunshine into heat. Not into heat, but into electricity. This electricity is either stored in batteries or sold to the grid. Breaking news for consumers. Solar electric systems can produce electricity at a lower cost than you can buy it from the electric grid retail. I reckon that we can install in Barbados PV systems at around $10 per watt and perhaps produce it at about 44 cents Barbados dollars per kilowatt hour. So, simple step, get solar electricity for your home or office, no. Okay, let's get back to solar. Get a solar dryer. Often neglected, the use of solar for applications other than photovoltaic and water heaters is still big, it's still real, and it's still viable. We are suggesting that in the solar system, on the left, the heat enters through the glass and heats the crop, or we can have the heat going through a water heater panel or a panel collecting air and it goes into the drying chamber. This is also a no-brainer, and quite a lot of the food that is shipped throughout the world is shipped dry, and we have some spoilage in Barbados that can be up to 40%. So what I'm saying is that find a drying expert, get a solar dryer, find one, use one. Step 7, the wind blows on these blades. They rotate, the rotation is converted in up and down motion. This dries a punt. That simple. It's almost like 60s music. We all knew it happened. Some of us still use them, but most of us have forgotten how good it was. Wind water pumps can be used for any irrigation application, anytime, anywhere. Import a pump, make one yourselves. Grow plentiful crops. When do we start? Start now. Step 8, driving with cooking oil. This is almost like a kitchen recipe. Biodiesel is made simply from stirring vegetable oil with alcohol and separating the two layers. Actually, the layer that you throw away is soap and can be sold. This is better for your diesel vehicle. This can be a cottage industry, a large plant, or you can actually get raw materials, cooking oil, use cooking oil extracts from palm tree, jatropha, etc. We are been planting palm trees in Barbados for decorative purposes. They're going up all over. What we don't realize is that those palm trees that we have planting in our gardens and along the highway, those fruit can actually be used and you can extract the oil and mix it with ethanol and produce diesel that you can put in your oversized Jeep, diesel running Jeep. Sorry, I meant energy efficient diesel Jeep. Okay. Okay, that was hilarious. Here's another one that's hilarious. I call this one rum running. Ethanol milled from crops has similar properties as gasoline and can be used directly by some cars. Flex fuel cars, or blending gasoline for most of our cars. So where do we get it from? Surprise. Ethanol is basically rum. 100 proof rum is 50% ethanol, I'm told. I've not tested it, but I'm told. Divide the proof by 2 and that's what you get. All we need to do is remove the tiny, tiny amounts of the totally 100% ethanol that's of water that's still there, and this is done using something called a molecular sieve, and we can then start putting it in our gas tanks. So the simple step is produce ethanol locally for cars, we may hear about that later, or import cheap one from Brazil, take out the water, use it locally, or send it to the United States, and make lots of money. Step 10, power from cane trash. For over 200 years, I was writing 300, but my history is not so good. So I'm sticking safe with 200 years. The production of sugar was dependent on bagasse, cane trash. And in most cases, the sugarcane plant has produced more bagasse than we really, really need to produce sugar. And we've therefore been wasting the bagasse, and that can stop now because we can actually put in a better plant at the sugar factory and use this bagasse more efficiently, and we have excess heat, and use that excess heat to produce electricity, sell it to the grid, and earn some money. My guess is we can look at a 10 megawatt generator. We'll hear more about that later from one of our presenters. So that's step 10. Step 11. Since we're burning, let's burn our trash. We currently separate our solid waste and produce some organic material that can be used for energy rather than taking up space in the landfill. Yes, we have a dense population and we don't have a lot of space, so sometimes it's better to convert some of our waste to energy than actually putting it in the landfill. Burning this waste to produce energy is similar to the technology used in the local generating company steam plants, coal plants through the world. It's not rocket science, we can do it. We are a small island and too much of our space is being taken up by landfills. We can do better. The better that we can do has been announced by the Minister Low a couple of weeks ago. We can get cash from our trash, converting our trash into energy and into money. So, next step, natural gas. Hold on a minute. Natural gas. We know natural gas comes from the same wells as oil. And it's a greenhouse gas emission for fossil fuel. The more natural gas we use, the more climate change we're going to have. This is not necessarily good for the environment. Natural gas, by the way, is 79% methane. And there are some bacteria that can actually produce the same methane from organic materials. And these are called anaerobic bacteria. And you can get this methane by this bacteria's action on vegetable materials, animal waste, etc. So our simple step here is to look at getting natural gas from waste materials, waste crops, industrial waste, and of course, at the bottom of our landfill, we heard about later on the natural gas, the methane that can be produced there. The minister mentioned that we can actually look at producing air conditioning from our oceans. One of the biggest peaks of significant loads on our electricity is for air conditioning during the hot summer days that we are experiencing now and the most times during the year. We know that the sea is cool, and if we go deeper in the sea, it gets cooler. There is actually technology that you can actually take large quantities of this water from deep in the ocean and bring it up to the surface, and you have cool water. And you can use that to cool buildings, hotels, etc. So that is technology that is considered through the study mentioned by Minister Boyce that it's viable and investments could be on your way. Okay. Offshore wind, the flip side of offshore drilling. Isn't it pretty interesting we look at these offshore wells, not particularly ones that have been having problems in the United States, but we look at offshore wells and this big platform in the sea, and there's a pipe going down trying to look for energy. Yet if we take that pipe and stuck it in the air, just a few meters, we get energy anyway without all of the promise of pollution. Offshore wind is considered to be viable in the report that was done by the IDB. And basically that is now one of the steps that we could consider. Technically it is viable if we can find offshore areas that are typically on average less than 100 meters. Step 15, as led by our water heater manufacturers in 1974, there is an opportunity for us not just to install alternative energy systems that are brought in from overseas, but there's a definite opportunity for us to start manufacturing of other alternative energy systems other than solar water heaters. Through the leadership of a water heater industry, we can now look at wind, we can look at photovoltaics, and we can look at other things like solar stills, etc. So our step here is shift some of the support, add additional support to start large-scale manufacturing. And we'll probably hear more about that from our BIDC CEO, Mr. Levine. Dr. Eswit mentioned that in order for us to move to alternative energy development, we have to build human capacity. We plan a revolution in the use of alternative energy. We need to introduce new technologies in wind, big and small biogas digesters, waste energy, solar, etc. Yet there are not really any Barbadian institutions that offer training in any of these areas of fast emerging technologies. Do we need to expand our education of alternative energy into our primary schools, our secondary schools, tertiary institutions, as indicated by Dr. Eswick? My response is yes. We need to set up and support training and educational programs. Now, for the alternative energy that we cannot build, we can certainly service, advise, and describe. There is an opportunity, obviously, as may be mentioned by Dr. Clark, that alternative energy services can be a new vogue in terms of opportunities for the private sector. We cannot always manufacture these complicated devices, but we can offer these services in Barbados and throughout the region in system design, wind farm planning, etc. So we have to develop alternative energy services industry, or shall I say, typically in development of alternative energy industry, the service sector that supports this development also occurs. Okay. They say seeing is believing, and to a large extent, people only believe sometimes if they can visit your house and see what is happening. We all believe that solar water heaters are working because we know our neighbor has one, and we visit our neighbor, and the neighbor says, fine, here it is, it's working. But in many of the other alternative energy technologies, we have not had the opportunity to see them work. So what we need to have more of is what Dr. Simmons has done, are people who have stepped up to the plate and put their systems in place and made them available for the public to see. So a simple step here is for each of us or the country to have more demonstration systems, and Mr. Boyce would have mentioned a little bit about that in his presentation in terms of what the government is doing. Step 18, congregate. The governor indicated that we will be having a alternative energy network. We need to come together more often, as we have done today and tomorrow. We need to have the meeting of the minds and exchange views and take this simmering optimism into reality. We may not need to congregate in persons, we can congregate virtually on the web, Facebook, etc. But one of the forces that takes forward the development of industry are for people to get together and determine as a collective body what the options are, exchange ideas, etc. So those are the 19 steps. And of course, in 13 hours, around 4 p.m. tomorrow, the curtains will be drawn on the single most successful alternative energy meeting held in the history of Barbados. And this meeting could be heralded as a proverbial turning point in the development of alternative energy. We can be identified as a public-private sector assembly that has the decisively committed to a greater and more sustainable energy vision for Barbados, a decision that will yield a greater determination for faster, bigger alternative energy goals. But we can only do that if we hone and focus on this last, and I suspect, single most important step. Act now. You have acted now by being here. You've acted now by listening to the announcements of this alternative energy workshop and calling and indicating that you're going to be here. You've acted now by actually coming. Congratulations to you. And today and at the end of tomorrow, the simple and final step is not just to act in coming here, but as you leave tomorrow at the end of this workshop, act again, act then, act tomorrow, act now. Thank you.